Hi everybody, welcome to day two of DroidCon. We've got an interesting set of talks lined up today. Most of the systems talks are lined up today. Gaurav, who should be coming in a bit, will introduce them to you a little later in just a bit. And we also have the design track running in the second half of the day. But right now, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker of the day. I'd like to welcome Narendra Bhandari. He is the Director of Asia Pacific of the Intel Software and Services Group Developer Relations. So in his role, he focuses on developing the software solution market across all of Asia Pacific. And his background, sort of his core roots are development. He's got a bachelor's and a master's in computer science. And he's going to be talking about differentiation for developers on the Android ecosystem. So please give him a big hand and please welcome Narendra.
Morning. Is there an echo? I hear. Okay, better? All right, good morning. What we're going to do is talk a little bit about how do you look different, so to say, or what can you do to look different. This is a world which changes. I mean, every 6 months is an eternity in this world. The environment is so dynamic that practically every other week something is going on in the industry which changes the foundation of it in many cases. But there are certain things which are sort of, you know, going to happen anyway. Let's quickly look at the ecosystem we'll talk about and what I think some of the gaps are and the opportunities. I show this slide to a lot of people, and I've, you know, shown this in the past, where the good news is the app economy, from a download perspective, from an interest perspective, continues to grow, right? We haven't seen any significant worrisome signs of slowing down or, you know, even stagnating or anything to that effect. And the challenge I always say on this slide is, how many pixels are you gonna occupy or is your app gonna occupy in this sort of worldwide relatively crowded space? The continuous challenge for developers, I think, you know, and you guys, from what you guys tell us is once I build it, once I have the idea, how are people going to talk to me? How are people going to recognize me? How are people going to know me? How do I make myself relevant? How do I make myself popular? And more importantly, you know, stay healthy. So, you know, we are seeing some numbers that approximately, you know, 20% odd people kind of, you know, get there, but they don't. 80% don't come back, and 20% come back, and then, you know, there is a progressive down. Now, in the larger scheme of things, in the earlier slide which I showed you, this one's okay because the pie is expanding constantly. The number of devices are expanding constantly. But from a developer perspective, there is a sign of worry here a little bit, which is, am I really able to hold the attention of, you know, the consumer who came into either my site, to either my app or to the store, and then get to the next app and, you know, potentially even pay for the next app. A very local comment is, you know, people say, well, I have a bunch of worldwide apps, etc., but are there things which make my life more productive for my local environment, you know, let's say from an Indian context? So I would kind of go off and say, yes, there's a lack of India-specific apps and content. Now, there could be many rationale to this. The usual answer, at least I get, is money, right? What do I do? I mean, if I just make it for India-specific content, can I potentially make enough money? Is there enough volume? Is there enough business, etc.? And on the other hand, what we find, what we see, at least from the data, is that everybody seems to be selling mobile phones these days, or at least tablets these days, in some way, shape, or form. The number of brands, we're told, is running into tens and tens of, if not hundreds, in terms of, you know, we've got fruits, we've got cakes, we've got all kinds of brand names which are, you know, going off into the space. So it's also a little encouraging. The question always becomes, who am I? how will I be visible, how will I get paid for all this, where am I, you know, gonna go? Just in the last 2-3 weeks, several of us, including myself, were in various parts of California going around, and I had a chance to meet with a variety of people, including, you know, when you're there, you go off and meet friends and, you know, figure out what's going on in life. The momentum, even there, at least from a, you know, you go visit a typical family, a friend of mine said, you know, my budget for phones this year is $1,000. I said, wow, that's a lot of money you're spending. Well, my budget for phone is $1,000 because I'm 2 years in and I have to upgrade hardware. And then for his kids, in addition to their, you know, whatever school budget, he's got an app dollar budget per kid, right? And that's, if you argue for a minute, that's an economic shift in how a home budget is being done within a family, right? I'm gonna go to 2 movies a month, I'm gonna go to restaurant 3 times a month, and now you can download X number of apps or value of X number of apps, right? I don't see that too far away, even for many of us. I've lost track of how many gadgets are in my family, but you know, I'm a miser. I don't have my credit card entered so that my son can't go and get stuff, but I'm not too far away from that either, at least in this part of the world. That's good news and bad news for you guys. Right? Good news is you're part of the family budget, or your developers are part of the family budget. The challenge is you want to make sure that, you know, you're consumed sort of within that family budget. So we raise this question consistently, that is this economy healthy enough? Are you guys, you know, thriving, so to say? Because it's not just about thriving, it's about then you're going to go off and invest more into innovation and differentiation. And we'll talk about that a little bit, right? A little bit of how we work with the community, I'll run through a little bit of what we do, and then we'll come back in on this conversation about differentiation. So, you know, you could argue that there are many stages in how you potentially build an app. You know, start from the idea and go all the way and build it and deploy it. This is the development portion, and there's a marketing and business development portion also. What Intel does at the early stages is, you know, we've got app ideation contests, right? For people saying, well, I have an idea, but I'm not sure if it's going to be. So, well, can we help you be part of an ideation, you know, game? We have variety of developer challenges for people to go off and build, and I'll show you a few. More recently, you know, we started talking about something called a SparkSub forum, which is very relevant to a local audience, right? At the NASCOM product conclave, we started this discussion with a variety of thought leaders, which is, can we go off and do things which are slightly different, slightly local, in terms of applications, in terms of language, in terms of communication, in terms of not just an app. In many cases, maybe it's an app plus a piece of hardware. Some hardware, watch, this, glass, you know, biometric, phone, whatever, doesn't matter, right? And start a thought process which is different, not just the standard developer program from an application's perspective. Then as you get into development, you know, we'll talk about the various devices, various tools we'll touch upon a little bit. One of the things we heard a lot of feedback over the last several years as well, you know, the apps from, you know, this part of the world are not exactly the best quality in terms of the user experience, the design quality. So we started bringing in people who are experts and helping some of the application developers, saying, you know, do a makeover, so to say, do a before after, help people clean up, help people, you know, design the fonts better, text better, colors better, you know, down to that silly stuff. And also remind them to, maybe can you like spell check before you publish your app? Because we found a bunch of apps which were, you know, the guys forgot to run a spell checker, you know, when they submitted the app, right? So very basic things, just so that, you know, you don't put off your consumer. And then of course, getting into potentially differentiation, optimization, validation, getting the best out of whatever hardware you're deploying. Of course, in our case, we were telling people how to get the best out of Intel hardware, but at least getting that mindset and have a context of what the device you're gonna be running on, and do a few things which could differentiate better, you know, than you would normally. Right? I won't go through all of this, but the top left one, you can't read it, was the perceptual challenge. It was a $1 million challenge at a worldwide level. You guys contributed significantly. I think, you know, Sachin, we were, what, number 3 in the world in terms of entries in round 1 and round 2. Basically, you know, this was largely driven around how do we interact with the computer with gestures, right? Camera, sensors, etc., and that's getting extended to other parts, other operating systems also. Project Anarchy is again an engine. I'll talk a little bit more about that. There's a mobile challenge there. How many of you develop games? Anybody here? Few hands. Yeah, so we can talk about that and on what we can do from games. You know, we talked about SparkSub. We talked about the app innovation where many people come and say, I have an idea, but I don't know how to curate your idea. So these innovation contests are to help you curate the idea a little bit more with some amount of mentoring. Right? From a product perspective, commercial for the product, getting into what is called, you know, now a Baytrail architecture, you'll hear that, you know, if you search Baytrail, you'll see a lot of it. Again, the product name is Atom, and underlying architecture is Baytrail. 64-bit, right? Believe it or not, 64-bit is becoming important. How many of you feel your phone is slow? Jeez, just keep those hands. People turn around and look at those hands, right? What does it tell you? Right? It's kind of beginning to feel, I mean, several years ago we said, fine, how much computing do I need in my hand anyway? What am I going to do? Right? And today, we've packed so many things into that. Right? Yesterday, I was just telling my colleagues, we were getting into the car after having some ice cream at, you know, in Koramangala, getting ready to go for a movie, and one of my nieces sat in the car and said, Dad, where's my life? Any guesses for what she was referring to? Right? So, and most parts of her life is in that device, right? And we're packing it like crazy. So technologically, we argue, like, 64-bit? Well, 64-bit, of course, right? Performance and many other things, you know, beneficial, right? So, we've looked at this. I mean, I've been involved with Intel now 20 years, and when we started looking at 64-bit, I don't know, 15 years ago plus, we started saying, well, how many people in high-performance computing are going to need a 64-bit? Now we're down to mainstream, right, where at a mobile level, at a tablet level, you potentially need 64-bit. All the other stuff, you know, it's, you know, pretty straightforward. We're going to make it a very efficient core power. We'll talk about it, and then, of course, building it on the best performance technology. This is, again, just very quickly focusing on battery life, imaging, graphics. Interestingly, we're going to start seeing that, you know, the stuff runs, you know, multiple operating systems, right? We'll start with Android, start with Windows. Many of our core platforms are already running Chrome OS, and of course, the processors go into the Mac platform also. So you'll start to see, you know, those variations and many, many different form of designs. You know, people are coming up with all kinds of stuff which they do, right? So we'll see some stuff today. I want to show you a few things. I want to show you all of that. There's a booth. You can go check it out. We'll talk about WiDi. It's an interesting usage. WiDi is a technology which enables it, but it's an interesting usage of small screen to large screen on what happens. You know, multitasking. How many of you use multitasking on your phone? Boy, we're a messed up set of folks, right? We always, again, from an engineering perspective, we always feel that, really, is somebody going to do multitasking on their phone, or is it largely going to be one thing? But it's coming down to people are like, you know, shifting. I mean, I was searching for something last night on the phone. In fact, I was trying to book my tickets while eating ice cream. I was searching for that, and then while that page was downloading, I was going on a different page looking at the review and then coming back to the app to book the ticket. It's getting, the message I'm trying to get to is it's getting to be clearly a part of our life, but it's getting to be a part of life where our patience level and its responsiveness, etc., is going to be a huge challenge. Right? So, okay, I'm going to move on. I'm going to invite Nalina on stage. So we're going to talk about performance. So what we'll do is we'll use video, which is probably the most simplest workload, to, you know, highlight performance. All right, morning. Welcome, Nalina.
I'll be demoing two features at a time.
Wait, I want to watch a rock video now. No, I'm scared. Sorry. Okay. Oh, mic. Your mic's turned off probably.
It's on?
Say something.
Hello.
Yep, you're on.
Today I'll be demoing two features at a time. One is Intel wireless display and also the battery performance.
Okay.
So I have an application which is called MX Player, which shows the, both the features enabled. So here I'm playing a 1080p video, HD video, and
so
what
you
I'm
may
trying...
Wanna, you may want to clarify, we do this every time, right? That stream is coming from this tablet.
Yes, this is the wireless display which is happening here, Intel wireless display for 1080p HD video. And meanwhile, I play there, I can always use my tablet for other purposes. That's the multitasking enabled on Intel WiDi. So, and one more feature which I was talking about is the hardware and software decoding. So what we have here in MX Player is the hardware and software integrated on the same MX Player. So I would like to show you here right now. Let me switch on the software decoding part. So this is the option available which shows you the battery backup. So in software decoding, the battery consumption is more. So I don't want to waste my battery on running out of video.
Sure.
So let me switch it on to hardware decoding. So this is the performance which we get boost up on the hardware decoding, where it is most of it is pushed onto GPU offload.
Somehow his song is now was slow-mo and now getting to be more real. And you guys should go check this out in the booth also, right?
Yeah.
So two or three things messaging here. One is, first of all, this whole usage, right? It may appeal to a class of audience. You know, we'll see how this evolves, where you're sitting at home potentially, and in the education space, we've seen this, you know, interesting usage model where you're doing something on the tablet and then, of course, also streaming something on the television. The other message there was on performance, where if you're able to take, I mean, if you're writing the standard Dalvik, great, but if you're able to take advantage of the hardware capabilities, you'll actually deliver, the video seemed better at least,
yes,
visually,
correct,
right? And I know we didn't turn on the audio and everything else. And of course, you're saying that it'll actually use lesser battery.
Battery, that's the...
Yeah, lesser battery is kind of important for a few people,
correct.
So. Great.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Anina. Again, the it's very simplistic. The point, and I've showed this earlier, the point here is that you could use the hardware's capabilities to deliver a slightly better experience for your consumers. Could be a better, you know, how many of you have seen that ad where this lady goes for a designer dress and the guy asks her, well, what do you keep in your pocket? Right? And she goes, well, the usual keys, wallet, et cetera, and then she goes, TV. And the tailor says, yeah, then I'm going to have to make you a 32-inch wallet, right? Well, she's like, no, I watch my TV on my phone, right? So, I mean, I thought it was pretty great in terms of the, first, there's a generation gap in terms of thinking. Second, it's reality. I mean, you know, most of the, I shouldn't say kids, but, you know, modern generation want to watch their television on a slightly mobile device, right? So that's a scenario where we're meeting. In that scenario, performance, video, et cetera, is likely to matter for a lot of people, right? So, okay. So quickly, developers, you guys care for tools usually. It's important for your productivity. We have a series of tools. I mean, we've been building tools for the Windows platforms, of course, for several years, but if you'll notice that over the last 2 or 3 years, we've tried to make an accelerated effort to get you more and more tools on Android, you know, all the way from, you know, and initially we had a bunch of sort of discrete tools which we've now, you know, put together in the Beacon Mountain and the System Studio, where A, it helps you develop better, B, it helps you optimize and, you know, potentially improve your productivity of the application, performance of the application and your productivity. Havok is a company we bought, especially for the folks who are doing games and maybe doing some visualization simulation. It's an engine used, you know, physics engine used in many, many complex games. Engine you could potentially start using to go build interesting visual applications. I was telling the folks, last night I went for the movie Gravity. Anybody seen it? Wow, okay, so we're in the middle of geeks, right? So. I mean, stunning stuff, right? And just in terms of, you know, in terms of the visualization. And I'm personally a 3D graphics programmer. I wrote a lot of geometry code out of college. To me, the most interesting aspect is the eye, right? The camera, the angle of the camera in an environment where there's no gravity, and the character is rotating all the time, depending on the scene. Is just stunning intelligence of how to make that realistic and put it on a 40-foot, 50-foot screen and, you know, make it appealing, right? Just amazing amount of creativity. And Project Anarchy, again here, a lot of people came to us and saying, oh, we'd love to have a gaming engine which works on your platform very well, right? So we'll talk about this project, which is now available. And it's an interesting free engine, which, you know, you could go use. How many people write HTML5 code? Wow. Every time I ask this question, more number of hands go up, right? So I think that's generally good news. So we have a tool which helps you make cross-platform apps development. I'm assuming all of you write exactly to one platform, right? We know the answer. What you could do is here, use the tools, build your code, and then this tool will help you deploy your apps to multiple platforms. Where's my teacher for the course? Oh, there's Raghu sitting in the corner. So meet him at 10:45 in track 2, and he's gonna tell you how to write cross-platform tools using standards, HTML5, much faster, deploy it, test it, simulate it to various environments, various screen size, and a variety of other parameters, and he's gonna make your life a lot more productive. GameLoft, right? GameLoft, people know GameLoft, right? Yeah, some people use it. Some people don't want to admit that they use it, but, you know, we looked at these kinds of stuff over the last 2 years and said, fine, right? I mean, again, we talked about performance, we talked about battery. Gaming on mobile is getting to be pretty serious, right? It's beyond, you know, moving jewels and beyond, you know, throwing things and hitting birds, right? It's gotten to be a lot more complex than that. You need more engines, you need more energy, you need more juice. And the big players, the big studios are beginning to look at this space very carefully. In the middle of September at our Intel Developer Forum, we announced this partnership where, you know, the folks at GameLoft felt that, you know, we had something interesting from an Android platform perspective on our architecture and said they're gonna work with us to help go build a variety of games and use the hardware platforms, you know, to make. So if you look at, you know, Anarchy, if you look at Havok, if you look at GameLoft, and, you know, all these other engines across the world and players, you'll start to see that they're seeing the benefit of the performance, right? I mean, I can stand and say I've got great performance, but if a content company doesn't feel that performance is useful, well, suddenly I can say I have great performance, right? So that's what we're beginning to see, at least the big content companies telling us, right? Very quickly, CodeFests. I was part of this CodeFest for a short while. I was not coding, right, thank God. I was just talking to the people who are coding. So we've been doing a few of these across Asia Pacific. We did one a few weeks ago, lots of fun. These guys, you know, disappeared. And then they didn't come to the office for about a week, I think, after the hackathon. So yeah, they said, well, we're working very hard. But we're beginning to drive a lot of these community activities just to get the level of developers higher in terms of their engagement, in terms of their quality, push them, right? Again, here, the idea is to get you in a zone where you intensely focus on a problem, start coding, right? The objective is code, 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 get things done, improvise, talk to experts, you know, get better at it, right? And hopefully push you towards something very productive, something very cool, right? We'll continue to do this. We have one more tomorrow here. I think you just heard the hackathon announcement, which starts off later this evening. So one more commercial for you. You know, get strong joy. The way you want to use hackathons is, again, focus, 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 right? Get to a problem in your head, focus on the problem, get coding, right? You got to get coding. Now, you may fix a few things, you may solve a few things, you may come up with ideas, and then, of course, all the benefit of interacting with people, hanging out, sessions, learning, et cetera, right? So do those. Lots of community activities. Dushan tells me we've done about 5 to 6 in our facility over the last few months, right? Again, focus on community, focus on sharing, getting people together. No direct, you know, impact, at least from, you know, my business perspective, but it's important that we start building the community of people interacting, sharing, learning, figuring out what's going on in the environment, right? And then, of course, you know, if you want stuff from Intel, you know, that's a good one URL for you to sort of track where you'll find practically everything I talked about today. You'll probably, you know, find it there and just go look it up, right? So, marketing, right? The tough parts. We're going to try more and more to get your stuff visible. It's never enough, right? And especially the space is very crowded. We're going to try some interesting stuff. We're going to try some silly stuff. We're going to try some pretty serious business stuff. But get you more and more visible in different parts in different ways, because this is now a very consumer activity. And consumer touch has to be at a very, very different level. We're going to try many efforts through our retail efforts, through our, you know, customers, OEMs as we call it, and the range of activities have started to help you potentially get your app visible. And this is not easy, by the way. This is expensive, not easy, takes time, takes a lot of commitment from all sides, but we're going to keep pushing to get your app visible. Across all these sort of devices, momentum which is picking up, here we've got at least the public versions, not all of it, few more in the pipeline coming up. At this point, I want to invite Arvind Pani. How many of you heard of Reverie? Few of you? Okay, let's welcome Arvind on stage. Hey, Arvind.
Hi, Narendra.
So, since people don't know you, why don't you tell us about what Reverie?
Yeah, sure.
What Reverie does? We're going to stay away from each other.
Yeah, hi, good morning, everybody. I'm Arvind. I'm a co-founder of Reverie Language Technologies. Narendra mentioned about local language applications for different regions. So that is what we really focus on. One of the things that most of us do not know is that out of 6.5 billion mobile phones which are there today worldwide, only 1 billion users actually prefer English as their first language. Right, so there is a very large opportunity, including in India, Middle East, then whole of South Asia, African countries, to really develop applications which are for local markets. And that is what Reverie does, both from the device side, application side, and on the content side of it. For application developers, we have very interesting SDKs and plugins, which I'm going to talk about, that you can instantly plug in inside your application, localize that, and build an application in one language and really release that in multiple languages. So that's what we basically do.
Okay, you've got your slide up.
All right. So I think there is one slide before.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, here we go.
Before this one.
One more? There we go, yeah.
Yeah. So this is the opportunity that I'm talking about. Now, all the applications that we are building today for the Indian market, the ceiling really is 7% of India's consumers. We don't know that, but this is a fact. There are about 77 to 80 million internet or digital users who are today consuming in English language. Now, if it has to be beyond that, it has to be in multiple languages. The one of the important questions that I get asked always is that, is there money in building applications and services in local languages, right? The answer to that one is really yes. If you look at the other media which are very successful in India, print media, you look at the average revenue per user, this is annual, of course, is $30, right? On television, for local language consumption, is $50. Whereas on the mobile side of it, the ARPU is really, really very, very low. It's $1.35. And another analogy that I would like to give you is, if you take China as a market, where the entire ecosystem is very easily available in local languages, starting right from consumption of text, typing and interaction, and then, of course, the entire access and availability of content. There, the numbers, the ARPU number that I'm talking about from non-voice, where India stands at 1.35, China stands at around 10 to 11. So it's almost 8 to 10 times bigger than what India has got. So there is a very, very large opportunity that we can tap into.
Okay.
Now, what really are the current challenges? If you look at the devices, even from the best of the manufacturers, right? English language is at this level, and local languages is at this level. And why is this important? Why is this important for developers like us? Now, who are these users that we are planning to get onto the digital platform? Now, these are the users who are today consuming their local language text in the print media, in newspapers and magazines, right? And there is a certain level of user experience that they are used to over there. Now, when they come onto the digital, they expect the user experience to at least match what's there in the print media or even better than that. But that's not the case. There is a large difference between the user experience in print media and the digital media. Apart from that, the user experience between English language on a mobile phone, mobile device, and local language is to a point of becoming completely discriminatory. You can see that over here, right? There are no devices with this kind of English language support on those. So this is one of the challenges which is there. So this is where Reverie's SDK for application developers is very useful. And this has got the entire gamut of things that you would require, starting right from fonts, the ability to render those inside the SDK. There are keypads with very advanced predictive typing inside those. There are transliteration capability also built in. And you could use those either at the client side as well as at the server side. Now, we are also working with several partners. Intel is one of the important partners in this ecosystem where we have optimized our SDK on the Intel architecture. The kind of benefits that Narendra just mentioned about are accessible not just to us, also to the application developers who are using this SDK to build their application. You could really use Intel's partnership to optimize those on various kinds of form factors and screen resolutions. Then, of course, another important thing is the go-to-market strategy that Intel provides, the support that it provides to all the application developers who build applications on Intel's platform. Now, so far, there are more than 500,000 downloads of applications that are using our SDK. Very, very interesting applications. You may have heard of PlusText, which was acquired by 197. And as per their statistics, 67% of the message communication, total message communication through PlusText, were either in pure local languages or a combination of English and local languages, right? So there are other customers that we have as well. There is, we have a booth inside Intel's booth over there. You can see very interesting applications that have been built using the SDK. The other thing that has also happened is that the transliteration API that we are exposing, there are various kinds of services that we are exposing through web services that has already got more than 100 million API calls so far, right? And it is growing very, very fast. So you can know more details about us from our website. And if you have any requirements about building applications using our SDK, then you could use those.
Great. Awesome. Thank you. I'm going to stay away from you to provide, not have the echo. Yeah. So. Thanks, Anand.
Thanks, Navin.
Well, you know, you can go check out Anand's stuff in the booth, but in the context of the discussion we had earlier, which is try and get to more and more and more local stuff, we're going to see some of these efforts come in. We're looking at various technologies. Of course, you know, language is one, gesture, speech, all this at a layer which can have an impact to multiple developers. So if we go work at this sort of middleware, you know, above the OS layers and, you know, make it, you know, optimized, relevant for architectures, other developers can sit on top of it, take benefit of it, so you don't have to do that extra work and make sure you take advantage. And at the same time, use technologies like this to drive a little bit more deeper local relevance in our local market also, right? I'm sure there's value in people looking at their personal language of choice beyond, you know, just their business language of choice and looking at content in that area also. Just to close out, I mean, the space changes a lot. There are a couple of things which I didn't touch in great detail is this area of payments, or at least the area of exchanging value, right? There are various, you know, discussions across the globe. Bitcoin, of course, is the latest debate and the discussion going around. But the point remains that, you know, fundamentally for this economy, as I said, app economy to be healthy, we're going to start looking at mechanisms of how do we exchange value with each other. Happens to be money in today's case, but, you know, we'll also start looking at those efforts as to how do we, you know, work with more and more companies which potentially help you drive that exchange. We'll start looking at country ecosystems. Today, we look at, if you look at a place like India, you've got the biometric ecosystem starting up, you know, enabled by initially by Aadhaar, and maybe you start to do more authentication based on that. So those are things, you know, which you'll see. So we'll get back. The space changes a lot, right? Every 3 months you'll start to see, you know, something different coming out. So we'll keep in touch. But thank you very much. Questions? Sorry about that. I don't know if we had time, but oh, we have time. Okay. Yep. Shout it out. Somebody is coming to you, but I heard given up completely, so I like it. Has Intel completely given up? Oh, so if you followed the press for the last several years, that entire effort got morphed into what is now being called Tizen. And if you heard the press just in the last 2 months, clearly you've seen Samsung make a few clear statements around what they're going to do with Tizen. And you're seeing Tizen in several specific applications, automotive being an area where, you know, some of the big guys are carefully evaluating those technologies. So again, as you guys very well know, these things are community driven. You put into the community the base capabilities. End of the day, if the developers continue to pick on it, you know, that ecosystem grows, right? But for the developers to pick on it, you guys are gonna come back and say, well, what about devices, right? If I don't have devices, you're not gonna build apps. So that's the cycle. And right now, you know, you'll see, you know, at least let's see what Samsung comes out with, and then it kind of goes from there. So that Tizen community is very well there, very well active. Yes, please. Right behind you.
It's about the local languages. Are you guys planning to develop an app for that, or it's just only the SDK you guys are trying to develop for those languages?
Sure. Local so the languages. Last few slides you saw was a product from Reverie. Right, okay. And they provide capabilities, the SDK, to help you build content for several local languages. Now, if you want to build an app on top of the SDK, which you know Arvind and crew provide, you're more than welcome to. Our role is to make sure that more and more of these capabilities are available, optimized for our platform also. So if you want to build some interesting content on top of it, you know, your pains are slightly lesser. I mean, there's always pain, but it's slightly lesser. Right, and I'm sure you can have a chat with Arvind to figure out what you can do with that SDK.
Thank you, sir.
Hi. Is it possible to connect multiple monitors with Wi-Fi?
You have to speak up a little bit. I can't hear you. Sorry.
Is it possible to connect multiple monitors through Wi-Fi?
Is it possible to connect multiple monitors to Wi-Fi? Right now, WIDA is a peer-to-peer, is what Nalina says.
Okay.
I'm sure we can do some tricks, right, where you can, we can chat. There are some tricks you can do if you really, there is a need to go do multiple monitors. And I'm assuming when you say multiple monitors, duplicate multiple monitors, not extended multiple monitors, right? That potentially could be done. Extension, I don't know. That's probably not going to happen, so. One over there, please.
Hi.
Mumesh, yeah. Good morning. So I have a question on cross-platform development.
Something like happened. I can't hear you. Your mic.
Cross-platform development. It's like, actually, I'm a .NET developer. So how can the .NET developers can work on this Android development? Like any tools they can get it for?
I'm not the best expert. So let me see if I heard your question right and paraphrase it. How can a .NET developer work on the Android platform?
Yes.
Not sure. Depending on the application, on what you're trying to build, depending on, I mean, you could, I don't know. Yep. Tamarin, well, here's the community helping you. Anybody else, any answers? What can a .NET developer now feel the love in the Android space? Learn Java. Learn Java. The community is helping you. Now it's up to you whether you want the help or not. But I'm sure, I mean, you know, there are several connectors, wrappers, toolkits available in the marketplace because, you know, sure, you know, you could learn Java, but let's assume somebody had code, somebody had legacy stuff, somebody had investments already, and you want to take the best of both the platforms. There are tools to take a more pragmatic approach and make it work. I think in today's environment, cross-platform, there's enough people who've invested on tools and technologies to make things work on cross-platform work. So it's actually a great, vibrant ecosystem. All right.
Hi. So you mentioned in the talk that 64-bit architecture is something that's very important, and how everyone raised their hands when you asked how many people think that their phones are slow.
Yeah.
But then moving to 64-bit, or in general, the 64-bit architecture is not going to significantly speed up the user experience of any device. There was a significant improvement in battery life after the Haswell range has just come out. My own computer's battery life went up by 4 hours, 5 hours, which is great. But then in general, don't you think that it's important for software developers to be better at writing, say, optimized code than hardware manufacturers making their hardware faster?
Absolutely. Great points. You make some great points, right? The answer is both, right? What does 64-bit get you? For a minute, as an app developer, you could care less, right? But at the OS level, and regardless of which platform you are in, at the OS level, if the OS uses those 64-bit capabilities correctly, you'll see significant benefit in memory usage, you'll see significant benefit in performance, leading to even maybe better graphics and, you know, better battery usage. I'm sure there are lots of smarter geeks than me in the room who can give you a lot of lecture, but at least my little understanding from doing masters in computer science tells me that, you know, those kinds of things actually do help you to improve performance. Now, to your second question, which I think is probably the more relevant one. So the hardware companies will keep doing what they need to do. If I still kept the hardware 32-bit architecture from the 286 to 386 transition, we'd be a little slow. Your Haswell would be a little slow or running on 32-bit, right? Developers definitely need to pay attention, in addition to everything else you do in your game, to see what else can I do to write efficient code, right? That's probably the way I would keep it simply. Now, efficiency has many things. Efficient code could mean better use of resources on the platform. Efficient code could mean, in some cases, maybe going down to the deeper and deeper layers of the platform, depending on your taste. Efficient code could be writing better loops, writing better code just to do the same things. There are many ways, and that's where all the tools from the ecosystem help you gain those efficiencies. Typically today, most developers, they want to turn around the app quickly, they write the code, use some very high-level code, and then get it out. And once the usage picks up, it's like, oh my god, what else could I do to make it better?
That's correct, but then that's absolutely correct that people want, say, faster turnaround time with
that. Absolutely, and frankly, when you're getting your app out and you want to see whether this is going to get attention, I'm not sure I would advise that you start doing, you know, 3 weeks of optimization even before you release the app. Maybe not, unless your experience is very crappy. If your experience is decent enough, go out, see what people think, test your app, and then you can take it from there. All right, am I done, or I think I'm done. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was an amazing keynote. We have learned so much. It's exciting. You need to catch up the stalls, Intel stalls there, to know more about the technologies we have discussed here. I have a quick announcements here.